In this instance, I'm looking at the nameplate, which is at the top of the page, and I've got to find a font within my collection that comes as close as possible to this original. Keep in mind, the original was printed in 1829. Yes, so I've got to find something in a modern, relatively speaking, in a modern catalog that comes close to it. And of course, the Monotype machine is what I am dealing with. And so what better place to start than with the Monotype specimen? I suspected that Ultra Bodoni number 675 was going to be the closest match. Zooming in, you see the 30-point specimen right there from the Monotype catalog. And I'm putting the E from the Weekly Gleaner up against it, comparing. It's not a precise match in size, but it's within a couple of points of being the same. I know that Ultra Bodoni is a modern face, relatively speaking, and therefore it's not a precise match to the Gleaner, but it's as close as I can come with matrices for casting the type for the nameplate in this publication. This is a small portion of my collection of Lanston Monotype display matrices. Do I have what I need for this particular job? Right over here is 675, and right underneath is the italic. I had to repack all my mats in these plastic boxes because the original Lanston boxes were falling apart, and also they were taking too much space. So in this box you see that I have 14, 18, 24, 30, and 36 point, all in the same case. And so right here is the 30 point, and let's see if I can find the capital A. Here's the 30 point. Right there, it indicates 30 point. 675 is Ultra Bodoni, and there is a matrix for the capital A. These are what you call flat mats made by Lanston Monotype, the American company, and I'm going to be casting the nameplate for newspaper using my Supercaster machine. This is evidence the machine is called a Supercaster, made in England. It's a very rare gem in the United States because they were not allowed to be imported because they competed with the American Giant Caster. This is a matrix holder for the Supercaster. And here is a matrix that we looked at earlier. I put it in the holder. It's held in place by the two chamfered corners. And there you see the matrix in place, ready to go into the casting machine. So now I'll put the matrix in the casting cavity, which is right here, and at the same time I'm going to go over here and set the width again to 25 and a half pike points. 24, 25 and one half. And so the machine is set up ready to cast this character. There's a matrix going up and down, and I'll turn it on cast. Right there you see the character which I just cast. It's still hot, so I'll bring it out. There you see the character that I just cast. I'm on the way now to cast the nameplate. And so goes the Supercaster in casting capital A's. I'll have to do this for every character in the line. And of course, if I wanted to do the entire font, I'd have to change the matrix, and the set width, and check things out. And so we should be getting in just about now. There we go. And that's a procedure for casting type in larger sizes. You have to cast each individual letter, change the matrix, and go for the next letter. Of course, now that this type has been cast, it's got to be distributed into a type case, and then it will be hand set in the grand tradition of letterpress.
Going back to the original, you see that we have some special boldface right underneath the nameplate, and there's some strange figures involved in the date. That's the next challenge in the typecasting effort.
Certain things about the monotype which the computer interface will not take care of, and therefore I have to go back to the old monotype keyboard itself in order to cast a couple lines of type that I need for the top of the page. This big heavy thing that weighs about 35 pounds right here is what I would call the keyboard interface. That's what interprets each different metrics case. So that the same keyboard can handle a whole bunch of different operations. So I get that in place. That's the interface. This is a key bank, key buttons, which go on top of the interface. And that gives me the standard QWERTY keyboard. This is half of the keyboard. And here's the other half of the keyboard. You can see here that the keyboard is arranged kind of strange. You have a bunch of keys. You don't have things like shift keys on the Monotype. This is a lowercase, uppercase on the Roman. Over here is a lowercase, uppercase on the italic, lowercase, uppercase on boldface, and these black keys across the top are the small capitals. And so you have to press an F here, or an F here, or an F here, or an F here, depending on which character you want. I'm going to be working with caps in the boldface only, and that's why I'm working in this part of the keyboard. Now I want to remove the paper from the machine now. And right there is the ribbon which I'm going to put on the composition caster now. This is the composition caster which I'm going to be using for this little bit of ribbon. This is the paper tower. All right, I'm going to take out the mark from the last job. This is the old ribbon. Remove it. And this is a brand new ribbon, which I just finished punching. It goes into the machine like this. And it's loaded up. Lock it down and catch it right there. And I'm ready to do the casting. I have started setting it up, and the line is so long that it's difficult to hold the composing stick in my hand. I'm doing the proprietor's line right underneath the nameplate, which I set out a type that was in, believe it or not, I had already cast in a case, and I just got my line of type in there. I need a 2-point lead to drop in, and the parallel line rule, put it in there, and there's the line of type set in the stick. So I'm beginning to put the thing together. You can see here that I've got all the components of the nameplate done now, and if you look closely here, you can see that I have mixed the Century School Book bold with the bell figures. Here's what I'm referring to, as the figures definitely don't belong with the bold-faced modern Roman, but that's what was Linda in really the original. Linda really gets upset with me when I set up right here in the dining room with my laptop computer, but a great deal of the computer work that I do for the Gleaner will be done on this laptop computer. So come around to the other side and see what I'm doing. First step is to scan the original document into the computer so that I can actually read it, the document a little bit better. This is the original scan into Photoshop, and as you can tell, it's not very good. But with a little bit of work on it, I can change it into a document that can be easily read. And this is a sample of what I'm looking at right here. Now the next step is to use optical character recognition so that I won't have to re-keyboard all this information. And I've got an OmniPage program right here, which has the document up there. And I actually just tell it to scan the document. Okay, I'm scanning the document. You can see the yellow going down through it. It's actually looking at the whole document and turning it into keystrokes. And where the page is folded or something like that, and it finds a mistake or finds a word that it can't handle, then I have to change it. And wherever it's made, I think it has a mistake that it can't handle, it asks me for the correction. And this is right where the document was folded, and obviously it can't read the word, so I change that and change that, and that is okay. Business of. Okay, there's the way the document is scanned, and the last step is to save that document to a file, which I have done, And now I have keystrokes that I can actually read. And here is the document that has been turned into keystrokes. And you can see right here, this is the original over here on this side, right here. That's the original document. And these are actual keystrokes that I have from the machine. Now let's concentrate a little bit on the keystrokes themselves. You saw perhaps at the beginning that this word gentleman was in italic. Well, I'll turn it into italic. And a few other small things. Optical character recognition now is well above 90% as far as accuracy is concerned. But right here it got a numeral 1 instead of a capital I. And so I'll put the capital I in there. The result is that I now have keystrokes. I have taken this original document from scanning the original publication. I have converted it into keystrokes, and now I have a means of driving my Mac Mono system without ever having keyboarded the job in the first place.
In studying this document, I've discovered it's done in 10-point in a face very similar to modern number 8, but I do not have the appropriate matrix case arrangement, so that first step is to make a mat case.
Modify a little bit so that I can use them with this particular job. And so I'm in the process of taking the mat case apart right now. You see the mats have sort of fallen apart here. I'm going to take the mat apart. Yes, it is the right font. It's 10-point ABC, and that's what I need. So what you see here is that I have begun assembling the mats into this comb so that they will be usable. It'll take me quite a bit of time to get the whole case put together, but that's what's necessary. What I have here is a matrix case layout indicating where the mats need to be in the mat case for a 15-15 arrangement. I have succeeded now at getting the mats all arranged in the 15-15 arrangement, and my next step is to get them into the mat case itself. Sometimes it's a tight fit. They're a little bit fragile. I've got them arranged here now. I've got just got to get them down in there. As I say, it's a little bit tight, and sometimes there we go. The mats are in the case. Now I put the back on, or put two side bearings on to help hold the mats up. And the back plate goes on right here. And then we have four tiny little screws that go into the thing to hold it on. And here is a mat case that I'm going to be using in the machine very shortly, all made up, and this is evidence that you can make them up if necessary. Of course, you have to have the mats, but in my case, I did have the mats. I have just cleaned off the pot, and as you can see, I've got a lot of molten metal here. What you see right here is a nozzle that squirts the metal up into the mold, and I'll just pull the piston and squirt some metal. There we go. And you can see the molten lead being pushed up through the nozzle here. This happens every time the machine turns over, and each time it does it, it casts another letter. Piston's in position and closes the pot in. Look it up. And now I'm cranking the pot up underneath the mold, which is already in the machine. Caster's ready to go. This is the matrix case, which I just made up a little while ago. And now the matrix case goes into the casting machine. And it turns with the mats down, the cone holes in the back, and it slides right into here. And I reach around and latch it in. And the matrix case is now in the caster. lens back and forth that way, right and left, and in and out. And so the mat case is in the machine ready to go. One additional component that goes into the machine is the wedge. I think you can see the tapered nature of the wedge. This is a 10 set S5 wedge, which matches the mat case that I made. And the wedge has to go into the machine, and that's what establishes the width of each character as it's cast. Once you get it in there in the right place, the wedge is now into the machine, and so I'm ready to start getting set up for casting this system, and I hope to take you with me through the process. I hate this, the flicker, but nevertheless, that's what we've got. I'm going to set it up for MatCast Run, which is the software that was written to drive this thing. And here we are. It's a rather crude program, but line length is going to be 17 picas, and the set size of the particular type is 10 point. And so now I'm in the process of opening a file which tells the program where the various characters are in the matrix case, and also I'm going to be setting it up to tell it the set widths of all this stuff. And finally, I'm telling it to justify this composition. And I'm finally telling the machine that I want a text file, which I've already prepared, and it's called Gleaner. The 10 point is what I'm doing right now. And I'm selecting the Gleaner 10 point, and it's now in the process of working the entire file from beginning to end with regard to justification and making sure that all the lines would fit properly. Occasionally it halts while it gathers its memory, and then it continues going. It is moving along pretty nicely here. And finally it's gotten to the end, and it tells me that I've got 169 lines have been processed. That information is right here. And it's waiting for the typecasting machine now. The interface is hardwired into the caster, and the Macintosh sends the commands to the caster and tells it what characters need to be cast and when. This gives you a little bit better perspective on what's going on. Here's a Macintosh computer, and it's waiting for the casting machine. Now, if we look over here at the casting machine itself, we see that I have a series of air valves where there used to be a paper tower, and these air valves are controlled by a direct computer. We'll later on show a close-up. Little red LEDs come on each time each of the valves work. There are a total of 15 air valves set up on each side to control all the positions in the matrix case. Those air valves open and close at command from the Macintosh computer, and they drive the Monotype machine just as a paper tower used to drive it in the old days. Other than changing the paper tower to put those air valves in, this is the only other change that's been made to the machine. And that's a sensor, and every time the machine cycles, that tells the Macintosh to give another command to it. And the caster is running now, and each time you can see the bar going up and down. That used to operate the paper tower, and now it's just telling the sensor that it's time for another code to be sent to it.
At the top of the screen, you see the line of type that's going to be worked on. At the bottom of the screen, you see the same line being played out to the Monotype machine in reverse order. That's exactly how the ribbon works with the Monotype caster also. So the computer is doing the work of the perforated ribbon.
There's a result of the 10-point casting that I have just finished for the Gleaner. And over here is the mat case from which all this type was made. And the mats probably hadn't been in a machine for 35 years, if ever in a machine.
We're panning across the galley of type that's come off the casting machine. What you see here are sorts which I cast in case I need to make corrections here and there. Coming into view now is the heading American Enterprise, and you saw that on the screen quite a while ago on the computer.
Here's a 7-point mold. This is a mold. That's the first thing that needs to be changed in the machine. The second thing, of course, after the mold has been changed, is a mat case. And this is a Fauna Mats for a 7-point, modern number 8A, which is what I'm going to be casting. And the third thing, which is right here, is a wedge. Fast forward, I've already got the mold in there, the new mats and the wedge and all that. And I'm in the process of using my point set micrometer to determine the width of the character. And it's got to be 8 points. And looks like it couldn't be any better. So I've got the machine set up for the point width. The body, by the way, is 7 points, which is 1 point short of there. That's right on the money. So this quad is 8 points wide and 7 points tall. Here's a row of 7-point cap H's, which I've just cast, which I'm going to be using in my alignment gauge to make sure that it's on the body properly. Just looking at it through the lens here, I can see that the character is off to the left-hand side just a little bit. I'll fix that and we'll cast some more. Just to give you a feeling for the size of these guys, this Z right here is 30 point. And so a whole bunch of 7-point H's will make up one 30-point character. don't press it any buttons. It becomes a turning bar.
Looking down at the mechanism.
Well, I've finished all the typecasting now. All the 7-point is here, and here's the remainder of the 10-point. And so I've got to go ahead and finish the form now. And I'm going to start by assembling the right-hand column. I've got myself a nice brass galley set up with all the heading material in place. Now it's a matter of dividing the composition and getting it in place. It's pretty touchy because it is set solid. There's no letting between the lines. Looking at the manuscript, I see that the first line of type on the right-hand side starts with the words Customs of Nantucket in italic, and so I've got the fun right there it is. So I have to carefully divide the form so that I can get a hold of that material. As I say, this is set solid. There's no letting involved, so I have to be very careful in handling the type. I've got it divided, and I will get about 2 to 3 inches. Divide that. Get a slug on both ends of it so that I can handle the type. And there's the material. That's the first material to go into the page. And I'm going to grab the first block, bring it over, put it in. Be very careful. Be very careful. Bring it down. And that slug does not need to be at the top of the thing, so I got to get it out before I move it on down. And I've got the first block of copy on the page. And here I come with the second block of material. Set it down carefully up here. Bring it down. And almost pied it just then. I don't want to do that. Pull the slug out. Bring it on down together. And it's about time to put something on the side of the form to keep it from falling out on the edge. You can see a little bit of loose material up here on the edge. I'll put that up against it. Everything seems to be moving along just fine. The way the page is put together, it looks like they had a little bit of letting around this paragraph. And so while I've got it real accessible here, I'm going to drop a 2-point lead in there between those two paragraphs and push it down. I make sure my leading is just a slight bit shorter than the line of type, so all the pressure goes on the type, not on the leading, so that it will lock up properly. And at that point, I also need a cutoff rule according to the layout. Let's see if I can get it in here. We're at this point on the layout, and I need to drop a line of 7-point type, and then the cutoff rule. And right there is where the 10-point type is located. Here's the cutoff rule that I'm using. I've got it trimmed. It's a Linotype slug from Dave Churchman. I've got it trimmed to the right length, and now I'll just drop it in place. And to get it properly centered, it's 6 points, so I'll put a five pica slug on each side, and now the cutoff rule is in place, ready for the rest of the job to go ahead. To be positive, whatever that means, it's a filler to make the page full. There are two of them on there, and it has a little cutoff rule in there to break it away from the quotation that's right above it. So I'm putting that cutoff rule in, and there's your weak people line. And the column is finished. I've been making a strong effort to be historically accurate and match the fonts used in this newspaper as closely as possible, but I really came up against a problem with the italic used basically as the subheadings in the publication. Here you see the swash in, and here you see the swash in again, and the swash on the M also, in Mr. right there we see the swashy A here. This is representative of the modern Roman back in the 1830s to the 1850s, and this style was completely abandoned in later modern Romans. The first thing I did was check specimens that I got of matrices from the Kelsey Company, and here's a Xerox of their 1929 or 1921 catalog. And so I looked down through those specimens to see if I could find something similar to what we had. Of course, I had to find it in the appropriate size, and so I went to their 10-point listing, scrolled down the list, and right here is one that looks kind of familiar. Over here, it looks like I've got it in drawer number 118. So, and here are some of the characters we're really concerned with in the font. Looking real close, you can see the N right here with the swash on both ends and the swash on the tail of the M. These matrices may well date back to the time period of the newspaper, because the Kelsey collection came from a Typefoundry that went out of business in 1890. So Law Italic looks like a solution. Then all of a sudden I started thinking, didn't Lanston Monotype do Law Italic? The answer is yes, Lanston did do Law Italic, number 115, very early in the game. It's not shown in any of their more recent specimen books, but they did do the face. I didn't have 10 point, but I wondered if Sky Shipley did, and sure enough he did. And here are the mats that Sky sent to me. And we'll move it up closely, and you see that the M's got the swirl on the tail. The N's got it on both tails. It's a real fancy ampersand there. Face closely matches the font used in the newspaper, and so I'm going to recast those lines that have the italic in it so that I can get Law Italic into my job. Here are the special Law Italic characters that I've cast, and I want to get in there and get that A. So here you see the character dropped in, the swash character from the Law Italic, and just for comparison, there's what the A looks like from regular modern Roman number 8. Quite a bit of difference, and I'm very pleased that the Law Italic does align with the modern Roman. Here comes the first 7 point to go in the middle column. As this bar had indicated, it is set solid. That means there's no leading between the lines. As you can see, little letters tend to try to fall off at the end, so I have to be extremely careful with it. We're making progress. Here comes Mr. Noah's Best. Drop it in there very carefully. Oops, almost pied it. It's very, very difficult. There, we got it. Close it up. Mr. Noah's Best. I'm absolutely amazed that my pre-calculations have come out as closely. The second column is about 2 points short of what it should be. It's amazing because I'm matching point system types up against types that were made before point system. And so what I'm doing is dropping 1 point extra in at the break rules between the various articles. That should fix it up just fine. Perfect, perfect. The second column is now finished. Now I've got the name of the masthead pretty much taken care of. I have to get the slug out of there. And there's this heading, article, American Enterprise. Well, wonders of all wonders, I've just got that column finished. And I'm dropping an 18-point slug in. And I think the page is put together. Now I've got to move it into the proof press and see what it looks like, and unfortunately do some proofreading too. But there's a gleaner right there, and there's my reproduction in metal, just like it would have been done back in 1829. I just got the form out of the galley onto the stone, and I was putting my old pocket pole onto the original. Find the original is 52 picas wide, and it has some wrap around on the edge from the Xerox machine or something like that, so it might have been wider. My form is 53 picas wide, and measuring the type top to bottom, it's 68 picas tall, and my form is 69 picas tall. I think that's a fairly good approximation of the original, especially since even though Austin's note indicates that this is actual size, it may well be a little bit larger or smaller. I kid you not, I am just now locking the form up in a Heidelberg chase so that I can move it over into the Vandercook press. And boys and girls, the $64,000 question is my form going to lift? This is the first try. Honest, I am not kidding, the first try. Let's see what happens. I certainly don't want to drop it on the floor. Amazing. I've been sort of poking to make sure it does, in fact, lift. But there she goes, folks. There's the form ready to move into the Heidelberg. Backside, front side, ready to go. It lifts. Isn't that amazing? It's brushing. Clean the feet of the type. And by the way, I'm using a brass brush right here. This is the only time that you use a brass brush, and that is to wipe the feet off. And you can't see it, but it is knocking little flecks of metal onto the stone, which are a byproduct of the casting operation. Okay, and now I lay it down. Bang! Knock something down, unlock it. This is one of the few instances when a big planer is called for. If the form is now planed, lock it up again. And I'm going to do a little brushing on this side too, again, to get loose parts of metal off prior to moving it over to the Vandercook and pulling proofs. The form now is in my Vandercook. Let's see what it looks like. Inked up, print. My hands are filthy. Well, there you have it, folks. There's the first proof of the Weekly Gleaner, printed from the metal type that I have just composed. And here is the Xerox of the original document. And you can see there is a little bit of some similarity. There's a masthead. Small type, big type. There's what the 7-point looks like. Very visible, very readable. Even to the thick and thin rules and the thick double rules. And here we go back to the master. I have spent many hours studying this thing, and I think I've got the thing finished. Thank you. that case completely filled. So now, you're not supposed to spill things like that. There's no question about it. It's not supposed to be spilled like that. I have done these things hundreds of times and I've spilled them only about twice. But here we are on video. Amazing.